I'm going to show you how AMD's new Ryzen 6000 processor compares against Apple's M1 Pro. These are the main differences between these processors. Apple's M1 Pro is available with 8 and 10 core options, but I've got the higher 10 core here, which has 8 performance and 2 efficiency cores. The Ryzen 9 6900HS, on the other hand, is an 8 core 16 thread part, so fewer cores but more threads, and it's also got less cache. To do this testing, I've got Apple's MacBook Pro 6 with the M1 Pro, a $2,500 machine, and the ROG Zephyrus G14 from ASUS with AMD's Ryzen 9 6900HS, a smaller and relatively cheaper machine at around $1,900. However, you can get the same CPU but with a lower GPU than my configuration for $250 less. Although I've tested the M1 Pro in the larger MacBook Pro 16, the exact same chip is also available in the smaller MacBook Pro 14, and MaxTech has shown in this video here that there's basically no difference between an M1 Pro and a MacBook Pro 14 and a MacBook Pro 16. So although I happened to have the larger MacBook Pro 16, we can fairly treat this as if it was a 14-inch laptop for a fair comparison against our 14-inch G14. Temperatures varied between them when running a multi-threaded CPU benchmark, with some cores being much hotter than others. To be fair, these aren't directly comparable, as results depend on where sensors are in the chip and how software reports them. But it gives us a rough idea that when in a sustained heavy workload, both chips can run above 90 degrees Celsius. Now hang on just a moment, although both laptops do run relatively warm, we need to have a listen to the fan noise difference. Now, just full disclosure, while there probably won't be performance differences between the MacBook Pro 16 and the MacBook Pro 14, I would expect there to be some thermal differences. For example, people have reported that the MacBook Pro 14 runs with higher fan speed. But still, even with that difference, it's way quieter than the G14. The MacBook was running significantly quieter, and that's because it's drawing less power from the wall, as shown here. In the Cinebench R23 multi-core benchmark, the Ryzen 9 6900HS laptop was using 118% more water from the wall. A crazy difference. Well, I suppose it's only crazy if Ryzen doesn't also offer us a corresponding performance uplift to make that higher power draw worthwhile. So let's have a look and see how both chips perform in different applications. Cinebench is just a nice way to quickly get a rough idea of what to expect in terms of both single and multi-threaded performance. Don't worry, we'll cover more practical workloads next. The single core score was just 4% higher with Ryzen in this test, while the multi-core score had a larger 11% lead. So Ryzen in the G14 was technically winning, but for 118% more power, the M1 chip is clearly much more power efficient. We could of course limit the power to the Ryzen chip with software, something we can't do to the M1 Pro, but I decided to just run both to the best of their ability here. Performance on battery power is where things continue to get impressive for Apple. Although the Ryzen 9 6900HS still had the lead here as far as the score is concerned, the M1 Pro is essentially scoring the same whether or not it's plugged into power. The AMD machine lowered by around 1,000 points in the multi-core score, which to be fair is far lower than we'd see from an Intel-based laptop. But yeah, compared to AMD, M1 Pro is clearly more power efficient. Alright, back to comparing with both plugged into power for max performance. Adobe Premiere is a more practical video editing test and was tested with the Puget Systems benchmark. Adobe has an M1 native version of Premiere for macOS, so this was used for best performance on the MacBook Pro. The M1 Pro was reaching a 75% higher score in this test. Not too surprising, as generally I don't find AMD's Radeon graphics to do too well here. This test utilizes both the CPU and GPU, and you could argue that as the 6900HS has its own built-in graphics, it's not fair to include the discrete RX 6800S graphics. I've also included the results from just the Ryzen integrated graphics, so you can see the difference. And these are even worse. Those were the overall test scores. We can drill down into more specific aspects, like exporting for example. In terms of actually exporting a video project, the 6900HS wasn't too far behind the M1 Pro. But again, if you don't count the Radeon 6800S discrete graphics in the G14, then AMD is further behind. The live playback scores were much further ahead on the M1 Pro. It's not even a competition at this point. So expect a smoother video editing experience on on the MacBook. The differences in the effects score weren't as large, but still an easy win for the MacBook here. I've also tested DaVinci Resolve. Although Resolve itself does have an M1 native version for macOS, unfortunately the Puget Systems benchmark doesn't currently support it, so I've done my own video export using the YouTube 4K preset. I also wasn't able to run the test with only the integrated graphics, so this is more like a direct comparison between the G14 and MacBook rather than just the CPUs because the GPUs are being used. Anyway, the 6900HS system was completing the task 18% faster. AMD's 6900HS was able to complete my Handbrake video transcode test 83% faster. Although there is an M1 native version of Handbrake, which I used for this test, I believe Handbrake is able to take advantage of AVX processor instructions to complete the task faster. Things went completely the other way in the LLVM compilation test, with the M1 Pro completing this task 77% faster than Ryzen. This was one of the largest differences in favor of the MacBook out of all applications tested. Perhaps there's a good reason why so many programmers use it. 7-Zip was used to test compression and decompression. Both were extremely close together when it came to compression speed. However, Ryzen had a huge lead in terms of decompression, despite this version of 7-Zip having a native M1 option. Blender was tested with the latest 3.1 version, which has native M1 support too. Massive thanks to Tim at Hardware Unboxed for providing me the updated data, as a recent Blender update prevented me from fairly comparing the 6900HS otherwise. The 6900HS was 16% faster in the classroom and junk shop tests, but had a much smaller lead in the monster test. With the V-Ray benchmark, we start getting into applications that don't yet have full native M1 support. While running the benchmark, I confirmed that it was running via the Rosetta 2 emulation layer, so there could potentially be a performance improvement in future if this test is updated with M1 support. I guess you could argue this isn't fair, but the fact is, it's the real current state of M1. Not all applications have been updated for optimal performance. This is likely contributing to the 6900HS scoring 37% higher. The Corona Renderer benchmark also runs via Rosetta 2 with no native M1 version, which is probably in part why the Ryzen laptop was able to complete the task 43% faster than the MacBook. Veracrypt was used to test AES encryption and decryption, and is a bit of a weird one. Although there is actually native M1 support for this version of the software, it might not be taking advantage of hardware accelerated AES, which would explain why Ryzen is significantly faster. With x86 processors, the AES NI instruction set can be leveraged to boost performance. Honestly, I'm not sure what exists here for M1, but in any case, the simple fact is that right now at the time of testing, the latest version of Veracrypt clearly can't make use of any similar feature. Crossmark is a cross-platform benchmark that aims to benchmark overall system performance and responsiveness. This test has a native M1 version for macOS, and I found the 6900HS to score 10% higher than the M1 Pro. This test has three subscores titled Productivity, Creativity, and Responsiveness, which sound a bit arbitrary as I don't really know what they test. Take the responsiveness score for example. Ryzen is 34% ahead. Does this mean it's 34% more responsive? Probably not, given I'd say my experience using macOS felt smoother for the most part compared to Windows 11. But more number means more better, right? For example, if I use the speedometer benchmark, which runs in the web browser to test the responsiveness of web applications and scripts, after averaging 5 test runs, the MacBook scored 21% higher with Safari compared to Ryzen with Google Chrome. Speaking of less useful benchmarks, with regards to Crossmark that is, I left Geekbench until later because I just don't rely on the results. But some of you ask me for it, and a lot of other comparisons basically only rely on it. This test also has a native M1 version, and in the workloads run by this test, the M1 Pro was 21% higher in the multi-threaded test. Quite impressive given the lower thread count. Otherwise, the M1 Pro was also scoring 8% higher in the single core test. These are the differences in all of the applications just tested. The biggest difference was AES encryption and decryption right up the top for the reasons discussed earlier. Otherwise, LLVM compilation had a good lead on the M1 Pro, as did Adobe Premiere. The Adobe Premiere result here is more of a comparison between the G14 and MacBook, as I've used its higher score with the 6800S active. The M1 Pro would be even further ahead if we're just comparing it to the Radeon iGPU. Out of these specific tests, the Ryzen 9 6900HS is over 82% faster, but if we choose to not factor in those big AES outliers, then we're instead looking at AMD being about 10% faster than the M1 Pro in the rest of the test.
costs.
This, of course, only applies to this exact selection of workloads and isn't a general statement, as there are a random number of both single and multi-threaded tests here. But regardless, it's enough to show you that results really depend on the specific workload. Now, that said, we of course can't forget the differences noted earlier, like the MacBook using less power, running quieter, and still getting full performance on battery. It does cost more than the G14 though, but ultimately, the selection for you depends on the tasks you plan on using the device for, and to some degree, your preference of either Windows or Linux or macOS. If you plan on playing a bunch of games, for example, then I'd definitely be leaning towards the G14, because it's just objectively going to be a much better experience. Check out this video next to see how Apple's M1 Pro compares against Intel's 12th gen laptop CPUs. The difference is much bigger than what we've seen here, as Intel goes up to 14 cores, 20 threads this generation. So I'll see you in that one next. Otherwise, get subscribed for when Apple's new M2 chips are here and we get to do these comparisons all over again.